And you are listening to 94.1 KPFA in Berkeley, 89.3 KPFB in Berkeley, 88.1 KFCF in Fresno, and online at kpfa.org. The time is 1 p.m. Stay tuned next for Project Censored.
Welcome to the Project Censored Show. I'm Mickey Huff with Peter Phillips. On today's show, we look at U.S.-backed police state developments in Mexico and the increasing loss of human rights and attacks on journalists there. We'll speak with Laura Carlson in Mexico City. She's the director of the Center for International Policy, America's Project. Next, we'll have updates on Fukushima radiation and its impacts on the ocean and animal life, both in Japan and the west coast of the U.S. Marine radiochemist Ken Bissler of Woods Hole Oceanographic Institution and research biologist and professor Timothy Musu of the University of South Carolina, Columbia, share their recent research on the matter. To conclude the program, we'll hear a rebroadcast of a recent interview with Professor Carl Grossman from earlier this summer, who reminds us of the ongoing hazards of nuclear technologies in the U.S. and around the world. Stay with us. Welcome to the Project Censored Show on Pacifica Radio. I'm Mickey Huff with Peter Phillips. Our first guest today is Laura Carlson. She holds a BA in Social Thought and Institutions from Stanford University and a master's degree in Latin American Studies, also from Stanford. She received a Fulbright scholarship in 1986 to study the impact of the Mexican economic crisis on women and has lived in Mexico City since then. She's published numerous articles and chapters on social, economic, and political aspects of Mexico and recently co-edited Confronting Globalization, Economic Integration, and Popular Resistance in Mexico. And she joins us today from Mexico to talk about some serious developments that have been taking place there and encroaching police state. Laura Carlson, you joined the Project Censored Show.
Well, thanks very much for the invitation to be here.
Laura Carlson, hi, this is Peter Phillips, a co-host on the Project Censored Show. And I've been looking over this information about Plan Merida and how the Western Hemisphere Institute for Security Cooperation, which is what we called School of Americas for a long time, is training and militarizing Mexican police force and military in the South. What's been the impact that has had on civilians in Mexico?
Well, of course, this goes way back, and the impact has always been that it enforces an extremely repressive and violent and patriarchal model within the society. We know this already because of the number of dictators that have been trained at the School of Americas, the number of human rights violators, and the number of repressive government officials that have ended up taking a very dangerous role in the history of countries throughout Latin America. Now, in Mexico, we don't have as many high profiles. The country didn't formally pass through a military dictatorship, but there have been a large number of politicians of the ruling authoritarian party, the PRI, and especially the security forces that have gone through the school. It's important to realize that the problem there is not just that certain individuals receive training at the School of Americas, essentially in how to repress their own population, including the famous counterinsurgency manual that espoused and presumably trained in illegal practices, especially torture, which is a huge problem here in Mexico, but also the fact that it reinforces this whole model of militarization at a time when the drug war is being used as the vehicle, as kind of the excuse for bringing the army out into the street, but the real purpose is to be there and to put down local conflicts, most of which have to do with indigenous and popular defense of natural resources and land and territory.
I'm reading here that The U.S. has supplied over $3 billion in money to the Mexican government since 2008, and it's had, what you're saying, a very negative impact on human rights. How extensive is the drug issue in Mexico, and is it legitimate to say that a lot of that money is going to try to interdict drug trafficking? Or, as I've read in other places, the government is pretty hard to separate drug traffickers and the government and the military.
Well, we've looked at these numbers with the information that we have because there's not a lot of transparency or government information being given out regarding the Merida Initiative. We know the basic figures and the amounts of money, but we really haven't been able to analyze the way we'd like to the individual projects and programs that are funded over it. Most of it is a lot of pork barrel stuff that goes to defense firms in the United States. It goes to the manufacturers of the Blackhawks and the Bell helicopters, the defense planes, and other types of military and espionage equipment. But the result here in Mexico is truly alarming. The American Initiative comes in on the heels of the announcement of the war on drugs, which was announced to be a direct confrontation with drug cartels and their leaders within Mexico at the end of 2006 by the newly minted president at the time, Felipe Calderón. Since that was launched, and there's just no denying these figures, the rate of violence within the country has gone way up. There's 100,000 people that have been killed, most of them executed, either by security forces or in internecine battles between the drug cartels themselves. Just since that announcement was made, this is far, far and above what the average for drug-related violence would be in any years prior to the launching of the drug war. So the Merida Initiative comes in as a way to reinforce this disastrous policy, but also it's long been a desire, especially of the Pentagon and of the U.S. government in general, to have a stronger military and defense posture within Mexico. This forms part of a plan that began under the North American Free Trade Agreement and was expanded under the Security and Prosperity Partnership to make Mexico actually part of the security perimeter of the United States. And when you think about it, like if you think about it being the opposite way, the United States being part of Mexico's security perimeter, well, the first thing that would happen is that all the right wing and basically everybody in the United States would say, hey, we're a sovereign nation. And there's some Mexicans that are saying that, too. There's extreme violations of sovereignty that are involved in this concept. And it's made the United States kind of unconditional because Mexico has granted it so much presence, not of military, because that's prohibited, but of FBI, CIA, DEA, ATF, you know, the whole alphabet soup of agencies that are presumably linked to the war on drugs in some way or another, but are actually involved in all sorts of activities here in Mexico. And that's been a huge change in bilateral relations, and it's posed a huge threat, particularly to citizens who are in the opposition and who voice criticism of the current government or of neoliberal policies.
The unrest in Honduras and Guatemala, particularly Guatemala right now, has led to a large number of refugees trying to come up through the Mexican border. Now, I understand part of the money that the United States has been providing is sort of creating a more tight border barrier, similar to what we're trying to establish here in the United States, to prevent these people from arriving and trying to deport the ones that are there. Could you talk a little bit about that?
That's a really good point that you raised, because this has been a more recent development within the Merida Initiative. Although from the beginning, when former President Bush announced it, it was known as a counter-narcotics, counter-terrorism, and border security initiative. And there was already some funding for tightening up the southern border, Mexico's southern border, with Guatemala in particular. But then what happens is really tragic, because with the pretext of the crisis of the child migrants that exploded into the media last summer, we, at first, some people assumed there would be a humanitarian response to say, why are these children coming and what can we do to protect them? But instead of that, there was immediately this security response, which has made those children, their families, their mothers, all migrants from Central America even more vulnerable. On the southern border, what the Maritime Issue is doing is it's funding a militarization. That means that there are military checkpoints, not only on the border itself, which has always been very porous, a lot of crossing, and there's still quite a bit of crossing in informal commerce and that kind of thing, but also up to 100 kilometers inland. So it means that Mexico itself is being militarized. And it's all on the basis of a very kind of unexamined and absolutely absurd premise, which is that somehow destitute Central American migrants, more and more of whom are fleeing the violence of U.S. and national policies in their own homelands, constitute a threat to U.S. national security and or to Mexican national security. And this is such a wrong-headed approach to what needs to be done in terms of these flows of migrants that it's creating a real crisis in human rights abuses and another humanitarian crisis where Mexico has now come to the point where it's deporting more Central Americans than the United States, and there are vast violations of their rights as refugees because many, many of them have very real reason to fear for their lives.
This is the Project Censored Show on Pacifica Radio. I'm Mickey Huff with Peter Phillips. We're speaking with Laura Carlson. She is the director of the Center for International Policy Americas program. And Laura, we only have a few minutes left in this segment. Could you talk to us a little bit about some of the things that are also happening in Chiapas? And listeners should go to the website cipamericas.org to learn more. But perhaps you could briefly talk about that and then also maybe direct listeners somewhere for more information if that website wasn't it.
I was very fortunate to join the School of America's Watch delegation. We went to two places in Chiapas that tell very different stories. One of them was at Caracol, one of the centers of self-government of the Zapatista movement. And there what we found is there's a new kind of redimensioning of the Zapatista movement. There are people who say it's dead, it doesn't have the same national and international presence. But the depth of the movement was really on display there. The rotating governing board received us, and they described what autonomy means to them. And it just reminded us of what a really radical concept this is in a world that's dominated by the neoliberal model and by repressive governments like Mexico's. It's the day-to-day life of producing your own food, of governing yourself, of working to bring about gender equity in a very patriarchal and macho society. And it wasn't there like there were huge achievements or the resolution of all the problems that they have in this very poverty-stricken and violence-ridden part of the country. But the gains have been made, and they're evident. And there's particularly something to be said very strongly for the ability of these people to live in a relatively peaceful and harmonious environment, taking care of their needs without relying on a corrupt government to give them handouts. So it was a very impressive situation. And then the second place we went was to the southern border, and that was to Tapachula in Chiapas. And there we talked to some of the migrant families, where they denied us entry into the migrant station because that's what they do. They don't want really people to see what's going on there. And we talked to some of the human rights groups about some of the things I mentioned before, about the militarization of the area, about the way that this has stemmed human rights violations and has made migrants even more vulnerable, both to attacks by organized crime and by attacks from the officials themselves. There are multiple reports of both the police, the immigration patrol there, and the armed forces preying on migrants, both robbery, rapes, and all types of attacks. It's a real crisis situation there.
So the first anniversary is right now of the disappearance of the 45 students last year. What is there any resolution on that? Where do we stand on that whole situation that's going on?
Yeah, well, of course, nobody's been found, and nor have bodies. And so the uncertainty that the families face has just continued. And the situation is even, in terms of the investigation, is even muddier and than before. There's an independent panel of experts here that's come from the Inter-American Commission, and they demanded, for example, to be able to interview the armed forces, the Army, because it's very clear that the Army was on site during that time, and they were refused access to the Army. So they're about ready to give their final report, and everyone knows that it's not going to be a good one in terms of both the lack of cooperation by the Mexican government and the extreme carelessness and probably cover-up, signs of a cover-up, that characterized the Mexican government's investigation of the case. The movement continues. The parents continue to be organized, demanding that their children be searched for alive, refusing to accept the version that they were all burned at the Cholula dump. And more anomalies and irregularities and contradictions are coming up all the time. So the very few believe the real official version, which they've called the historic truth, but there isn't a lot of evidence about what really did happen, so the tragedy is ongoing.
Now, you're in Mexico City, and the terrible story about Ruben Espinosa and the four women that were with him were murdered about a month ago. He was a photojournalist from Veracruz, and he was the 12th journalist from Veracruz to be killed since 2010. The dangers for journalists in Mexico sound quite severe.
Yes, it's been known for a while, but instead of getting better, it just keeps getting worse. Yeah, Mexico is one of the most dangerous countries in the world for journalists, and the rate of prosecution or even investigation of these cases is very low. This in a context where, according to the data of the journalist watchdog groups, their registers are showing that almost half of these cases, the suspect is actually a member of the state, that is to say security forces or government. So you can imagine the contradiction of trying to get these cases resolved by individuals that are tied into the power and governmental institutions themselves. For us, this Mexico City case was really shocking because it long been considered that being here in Mexico City, we were safer. It was a haven. In fact, both these individuals, the journalist Ruben Espinosa, who had criticized the state governor there in Veracruz and who had filmed some of his acts of repression at times and been threatened for doing it, and the human rights activist and defender Nadia Vera, who also came from the state of Veracruz and who also had received threats from the state government. They both fled to Mexico City because of the situation in Veracruz. So the possibility, and of course we would hope that there'd be a real investigation into this, although it doesn't look like there will be, even the possibility that they were hunted down here in Mexico City in the nation's capital and murdered and tortured in this brutal way, is a real wake-up call, an alarm bell for journalists here in Mexico City and, of course, all over the country. So right now people are trying to organize to get the investigation to take into consideration the threat and the possible political motives in this case. But it looks like the city government that's in charge of it is trying to sweep the investigation and the case under the rug, and is coming out with these hypothesis that it was a robbery, despite the fact that it was gangland-style execution, and that they can't show that anything was actually stolen. So we're very, very concerned about whether the truth will come out in that case.
Laura Carlson, we thank you so much for taking time with us today to talk about these very crucial issues. I'm afraid we are out of time for this segment. We've been speaking with Laura Carlson, the director of Latin America Rights and Security Americas Program at the Center for International Policy. You can learn more at cipamericas.org. And special thanks to Michael Bass of School America's Watch, SOAW.org, for helping us connect with Laura Carlson. Laura, thank you for joining us today.
Thank you.
Coming up, we turn to the ongoing effects of Fukushima radiation on the ocean. First, this music break.
Welcome back to the Project Censored Show on Pacifica Radio. I'm Mickey Huff with Peter Phillips. We continue today's program with updates on Fukushima contamination in the ocean and in the biosphere. And we are joined by two scientists. We're joined by Ken Bissler, the marine radiochemist, Woods Hole Oceanographic Institution. Ken Bissler assembled an international research cruise to sample waters around the nuclear plant. And to date, important fisheries off Fukushima remain closed due to cesium levels above the Japanese limits for seafood. We're going to talk in much more detail about that with Ken Bissler. We're also joined by Timothy Masseau. Tim is a research biologist as well as a professor of biological science at the University of South Carolina, Columbia, and has studied the impacts of radioactive contaminants on biological communities in the Chernobyl region of Ukraine and the Fukushima Prefecture in Japan. And his research suggests that many species of birds, plants, and animals have experienced direct toxicity as a result of the Fukushima disaster. So let's dive in here and start. Let's start with you, Tim Masseau. Tell us about your research, and it sounds like very significant effects on life around Fukushima.
Absolutely. We got to Fukushima in July of 2011 and started looking at the birds in particular, as well as a few groups of insects. And the first year we noticed that there were drop-offs of many species in the most contaminated areas, and we've been tracking them for the last 4 years, and we've found sort of continual dropping off of many of the more sensitive species in the more contaminated areas, kind of paralleling what we've found in Chernobyl over the last 15 years or so.
That's quite troubling, particularly given, again, Chernobyl certainly is something that resonates in people's minds, and certainly Fukushima ought to, but one of the things that we've noticed here at Project Censored, we continue to cover Fukushima, but it seems as though that it doesn't get that much attention, and we think that's very problematic, particularly given what you were just explaining to us here, Tim. And Ken Bissler, let's talk a little bit about what you have been working on and what you've discovered regarding Fukushima.
Well, since 2011, we've been focused more on what's happening off Japan, because we certainly think the releases there were unprecedented for the ocean, and are certainly higher close to the source and at that time. Over the years, we're now starting to track that plume, those contaminants, as they move across the Pacific some 5,000 miles to the west coast of North America.
Ken Bissler, what's the status of Fukushima now? My understanding is that there's even higher releases of cesium and radioactivity occurring, and this is an unending drama that could go on for a very long time.
Well, it certainly can go on for a long time. I don't think the level today, we actually go and measure them every year. I'll be there in a couple of weeks, and they've dropped significantly. We had something like 50 million of these units we call becquerels, per cubic meter of cesium in the ocean. At their peak, they're down to maybe 1,000, so much smaller today, maintained at these levels because of the ongoing groundwater discharges of contaminated water, but certainly nothing like what we saw 4.5 years ago at the peak of the release, when they were putting cooling water directly on and it was flowing in the ocean and there were explosions.
How has this impacted British Columbia and the West Coast here?
We're fortunate in that, you know, the impacts near the source were high, 50 million of these becquerels per cubic meter of cesium. The highest number we're seeing now is 1, 2, 3 of those units off of our coast. Against, we have to remember, there's already some cesium in the ocean left over from the legacy of the atomic bomb testing in the 1960s. So we're talking levels that are millions of times lower, and therefore not of the health concern that we had in and close to Japan in 2011.
Tim Masseau, let's go back to you, since you have been studying the impacts of radioactive contaminants and you've been looking at this issue specifically in Japan. Can you explain what's called a mutational load and the consequences that's had for development and reproduction and survival in the region?
Yeah, you know, it's a really important concept, and what it really involves is the fact that the radioactivity, it's very significant, relatively high, but it's not high enough to kill these animals outright. And so many of the animals are living long enough to reproduce, and as a consequence, the mutations that are accumulated in their DNA are being passed from one generation to the next. And with every generation, there's the opportunity for mutations to be added, and this generates this mutational load which leads to lower performance, shortened lifespans, higher frequencies of cataracts, and other kinds of developmental abnormalities. So it's a very important issue. It's well documented in some of the insects in both Fukushima and, of course, in Chernobyl, and as well as in birds and mammals in Chernobyl.
Both Tim and Ken, could you talk to us about what is our radioactive ocean? What is this project, this ourradioactiveocean.org? Could you address what this is and what it's calling attention to?
Yeah, Ken here. Essentially what we found about a year and a half ago is a large concern as that water moved across the Pacific carrying the contamination, but no federal agencies in the U.S. that were monitoring. We could predict with models what might be coming our way, but we didn't have data. And so lacking those types of results, we couldn't really address the public concern. So we started here at Woods Hole a crowd-funded citizen scientist campaign where you and your neighbors get together, you raise the funds, propose a site, and we send you a sampling kit whereby you can fill up 5 gallons of water, ship it back to us. We pay for that shipping and do the analyses and post those results. So we've had great success, about 50 sites between San Diego and Alaska and Hawaii, some offshore sampling that's proving quite informative, where groups, individuals get together, collect samples, and we post them with attribution and what the results are. So it's been quite, I think, a good way to engage the public and also teach them a little bit about ocean radioactivity, just a simple lesson that there's going to be some cesium in every single sample, and what we can measure with our research techniques are the additional tiny amounts that are coming across 5,000 miles across the Pacific.
Ken Bisler, if listeners go to ourradioactiveocean.org, what they'll see is something called the longest swim crossing the Pacific for science. Could you just talk a little bit about what that's about?
Yeah, that's even more exciting or more recent. We have a swimmer, if you believe it, who is attempting to go from Tokyo to San Francisco. I didn't believe it. His name is Ben LeCompte until I heard that he had swam in the Atlantic in 77 days. But he goes in 8 hours a day in a wetsuit and a snorkel, fins on, and gets onto his support boat back in the same location. And if you do that, it becomes really a mental as much as a physical hurdle. You can cross the Pacific in about 5 to 6 months. And what's kind of exciting about this is he's using it as a way to, as a platform, if you will, to educate people about oceans and what's going on across the Pacific, from plastics to, in my case, radioactivity. So we'll be asking and looking for sponsors to do sampling 100 points across the Pacific, an unprecedented density of measurements that he can collect. And he's also testing out new devices, wearable devices that we're designing, so he could actually more readily collect samples and the public could use these to wear on your ankle, something that might actually be sent back to us for cesium analysis rather than these pretty heavy 50-pound, 5-gallon samples that we ask from the public right now. So we're very excited about this opportunity.
Timothy, I'd like to ask you about farming in the area. Now, you studied animals, you studied the birds and the insects, and they're certainly being impacted. Farmers have been saying that they're still growing food that we won't eat ourselves, but we go ahead and sell it. And an indication in China Post in March of this year, they talked about mislabeled Japanese products originating near Fukushima. In other words, 283 Japanese food products imported from the area were relabeled so they could be distributed and sold to customers around the world. Is that a continuing problem?
Well, I think you've caught me a little bit out of my area of expertise. This is an ongoing issue of monitoring and surveillance that just isn't being done at the level that all of us would like to see. Just as Ken has had to take some very creative approaches to monitoring the ocean, other folks we need to push for creative approaches for monitoring the foods. There are a couple of different groups that organized in Japan that are, attempting to ad hoc measure the food that's making it to the marketplace there. But I'm not sure to what level the exported foods are being monitored at this point.
And Ken Bisler, in an article called "Is Fukushima Getting Worse?", Robert Hunsaker quotes you or cites you, says that in travels to Japan measuring radiation levels, the site continues to leak radioactive materials, which you acknowledge, But he says that the strontium-90 is actually 100 times higher than it was in 2011.
We're concerned, I in particular and others, about different isotopes, not just the cesium. And strontium-90 is what we call a bone-seeking isotope. So when it gets in those fish, the food chain, and in our system, stays much longer in humans than the seafood and the biota than cesium, which is a salt and flushes out. The 100 times, I think, was mixing up ratios and the total amount that's there. Relative to cesium, the strontium isotope 90 was about 50 times smaller in 2011. They're getting very close to parity, so similar amounts of both, but both of them are at lower levels than before. One other concern we have are those tanks. If you look at the images of Fukushima Daiichi, the biggest change 4.5 years later are over 1,000 large tanks full of highly radioactive waste. And the total amount of water that's contaminated in those tanks and the radioactivity levels are quite high. And that's the number that's hundreds of times higher than what was released in 2011. So God forbid we have an earthquake or release from these temporary storage tanks before they can clean up that material, we would have an additional source that's quite large and of great concern.
We're speaking with Ken Bisler, a marine radiochemist at Woods Hole Oceanographic Institution. We're also speaking with Tim Musso, research biologist and professor of biological sciences, University of South Carolina, Columbia. Both of you are speaking various places around the U.S., and including in the San Francisco Bay Area. And both Ken and Tim, I'd like to put this to you. What are your views specifically? I know you just said something about, you know, God forbid we have an earthquake, you know, these kinds of things. I'm just curious, what exactly are your views on nuclear power? We've done a lot of stories on Project Censored over the years, and we hear a lot of public relations coming out of the various energy-type industries talking about how it is a safe alternative and so forth. But, Ken, let's go with you first. What are your thoughts specifically on that broad topic?
Well, you almost have to broaden it to all forms of power, right? Because burning coal produces the greenhouse gases and particles that cause health effects. So I'm not saying they all have their place, but maybe there are places we shouldn't be doing some of these things in, you know, earthquake active zones. The history of tsunami is not as safe a place as others for operating these types of facilities. And what you see in Fukushima is when things go wrong, they can go very, very wrong, versus kind of the more gradual effects you have of fossil fuel burning, climate change, coal mining, all those things that we can measure pretty readily.
New York, Vermont, the coast of California, I mean, we have these potentially ticking time bombs right here.
Yeah, we have sites that are monitored, and you can predict the very low chance of something going wrong. But as, again, Japan witnessed, sometimes that rare event, a once in 800 year tsunami, comes your way. And so the questions are, how ready are we for those, and can we be better prepared? And what are the alternatives if we switch to, you know, the greener technologies and wind and solar? You certainly don't have those chances.
Tim Musso, what are your thoughts on this?
You know, no matter what my thoughts are, the fact is we are stuck with nuclear energy for some time to come. There are over 100 new power plants being built around the world right now. There's over 400 in operation, or thereabouts. And so, you know, no matter what one thinks, there's really nothing we can do other than to prepare for these worst-case scenarios and to know a lot more about the potential environmental outcomes when accidents do happen. And it's not just the disasters we're worried about. It's the ongoing daily operations of these plants, which release vast amounts of radionuclides, as well as the smaller accidents that occur on a more frequent basis. I think there was a recent study that suggested there's going to be another Chernobyl-scale event within the next 20, 30 years, another Fukushima event within the next 10 years or so. I think that study was, you know, promoted by MIT, so a fairly credible source. So, you know, I think what we need to be doing is figuring out what the consequences really are of these kinds of accidents so that we can deal with them in the future when they occur.
Well, Tim Musso and Ken Bisler, I'm afraid that's all the time we have for this segment today, but we thank you for joining us and sharing this information, and we wish you the best in going around and speaking with the public to make them more aware of the Fukushima contamination that is ongoing.
My pleasure.
Thanks very much.
Thank you. We'd like to make an announcement. Fukushima contamination in the ocean in the biosphere is an event that will take place in the San Francisco Bay Area Wednesday, September 2nd. So that's coming up here next week on Wednesday, 7:30 to 9:30 p.m. It's a free event, and it is in Point Reyes Station. It is at Dance Palace, 5th and B Streets in Point Reyes Station. Again, it's a free event Wednesday, September 2nd, 7:30 to 9:30. Ken Bisler and Tim Musso will be speaking there. So will Mary Beth Brannigan, co-director of the Ecological Options Network.
We've been speaking with Ken Bisler and Tim Musso. After this music break, we'll continue on the theme of hazards of radiation. We'll hear a recent interview with investigative reporter and professor Carl Grossman. Stay with us.
This is the Project Censored Show on Pacifica Radio. I'm Mickey Huff. Today's theme, we are dealing with holding nuclear industry responsible for environmental contamination, human disease. And we are joined on the phone now by Professor Carl Grossman. Carl Grossman has been doing investigative reporting in a variety of media for more than 45 years. He is a full professor at the State University of New York, College of Old Westbury. He is the recipient of numerous journalistic awards, including the George Polk, James Aronson, and John Peter Zenger Awards. He has a weekly column running in newspapers around the U.S. You can learn more about Carl Grossman at carlgrossman.com. Carl, you join us today by phone. Thank you for being on the Project Censored Show.
Absolutely a pleasure.
You know, Carl, I have to start by saying your history with Project Censored goes way back to the late 1990s, but this is based on reporting that you'd done even earlier than that on the dangers of using nuclear power or nuclear energy and its connections to the NASA and space program. Let's start our discussion with that. Can you give us a little background on how you got into this?
I think the first Project Censored award, so to speak, or citation that I received involved my breaking the story. This goes back to 1986, about how the Space Shuttle Challenge's next mission involved a plutonium-fueled space probe. And I broke that story in The Nation. And imagine, consider, it would have been the May mission, 1986 mission of Challenger. Imagine if on that January mission, when it blew up, plutonium being dispersed with all that other debris that came down on South Florida. And I've been on that story, if you want to call it a story, ever since, the issue of the use of nuclear power in space. In fact, we've been seeing all this cheerleading for this New Horizons space probe, which has done a flyby of Pluto and sent back some very nice photos. Problem is that too, the New Horizons space probe, like the space probe that the Challenger was to loft, its electrical power system is energized by plutonium. Indeed, when that launch occurred of the New Horizons probe, this is back a decade ago, I dug into the NASA environmental impact statement for New Horizons, which acknowledged there'd be 1 in 300 chance of plutonium being released on this mission. I mean, if one knew 1 in 300 chance of winning the lottery, we'd all run down to our local off-track betting parlor this afternoon. And in fact, even the EIS, the Environmental Impact Statement, acknowledged that it would be spreading far and wide if there was an explosion on launch, and 1 in 100 rockets blow up on launch. The plutonium, said the EIS, would spread. I mean, you wouldn't want to go to Disney World for a number of centuries. If it got up and, like Challenger, blew up in the lower atmosphere or upper atmosphere, and the plutonium spread, the EIS spoke of it affecting large numbers of people. And we're talking plutonium, we're talking cancer. And one of the issues that I got into in exploring this is years back, and I continue to look into it, is the way the press has been so uncritical about the space program. There's a lot to be critical about. Indeed, one of the major reasons why the Challenger underwent an accident is because NASA wasn't careful enough. It allowed this launch to be made on a cold morning when the O-rings were brittle and so forth. The press wasn't, and I'd say now, doing its job in terms of the use of nuclear in space. And just let me jump quick. Beyond the environmental dangers, and these are big health dangers when you're talking about using nuclear power in space. One of the connections that I made early on, Beck wrote a book on this, it's called Weapons in Space. I asked the question, why use nuclear in space? I mean, maybe if you're going way out to Pluto, you need some nuclear power to the plutonium systems to generate electricity. On the other hand, there would be two plutonium space probe shots in 86, one to Jupiter and one to the Sun. Now, surely you don't need plutonium power if you're going to do a space probe to the Sun. You can do photovoltaic. As to Jupiter, NASA right now has a mission called the Juno on the way to the Sun, not using plutonium, but using solar photovoltaic energy, even though years ago NASA insisted you couldn't use anything but plutonium beyond the orbit of Mars. But let me just jump to the other connection I made, and that was, and again, I made it early on because I was looking for the answer as to why NASA was so insistent on doing nukes in space, and that was Star Wars, Reagan's Star Wars. Star Wars, it turns out, was predicated on orbiting battle platforms energized by actual nuclear reactors, or what were called super RTGs, super plutonium systems. I mean, now it's decades past, and thankfully Star Wars is and Reagan are long gone. Obama has been the president for about 7 years, and he has just discouraged the weaponization of space. But who knows what will President Trump, God forbid, do? What's in store for us in the future? Because the U.S. military is still very, very committed to dominance of the planet, control of the planet from space, and it's fell through the years. And my book, Weapons in Space, also another book I did on this issue, The Wrong Stuff, the space program's nuclear threat to our planet. The military has long failed to energize the stuff it wants to put up in space. It'll need nuclear power. In fact, a Star Wars general, and I quote this General Christensen in Weapons in Space, declared that without nuclear in space, we're going to have a long, long extension cord reaching down to Earth. So it's a big issue, nuclear in space. It's sort of a bookend to nuclear on the planet, which is also basically unnecessary. We could use solar, we can use wind, we can have safe, clean, renewable energy we can live with. But there are these interests, in fact, some are the same, pushing for nukes on the Earth and pushing for nukes in space.
Carl Grossman, can you talk to us a little bit about those forces, the forces behind this?
Let's just jump right to that shuttle flight involving the Challenger. Follow the money. Where was the money coming from? Where was it going to when you got to those space probe shots? Well, guess who made these what are called radioisotope thermoelectric generators, these plutonium systems? A company called General Electric. It wanted to have its hardware used, it's nuclear hardware used in space, and likewise on Earth. I mean, 80% of nuclear plants worldwide, this is historically, have been of General Electric and or Westinghouse design. These two corporations, enormously powerful, and we're all very concerned. I mean, now we're going towards the fifth anniversary of the Fukushima nuclear catastrophe, an enormous disaster which we'll be feeling for decades in terms of health impacts. Those six nuclear power plants in Japan Guess who the manufacturer was? General Electric. It does other things than, as its slogan used to go, bring good things to life. And also, incidentally, Westinghouse was acquired by a company called Toshiba, and later Hitachi entered into a partnership with GE in terms of its nuclear operations. So the two major brands in nuclear power became Japanese brands. And this all works into the enormous cover-up underway, and it's been underway now since the beginning of that disaster, the Fukushima disaster. You have the companies that are involved in the construction and the design and of nuclear power plants, again, led historically by General Electric and Westinghouse. And then you have the government nuclear establishment, which is enormous. I mean, it begins with the Manhattan Project. In fact, that's how GE and Westinghouse got their start in nuclear technology. They were hired as contractors during the Manhattan Project, and the Manhattan Project created an enormously vested in nuclear technology government operation. I'd like to explain to people how we got into this mess. The important years of 46, 47, 48, the folks at the Manhattan Project, this huge crash program to build an atomic bomb before the Germans, and that was the reason that Einstein signed that letter sent to President Roosevelt in 1939, which kicks off the Manhattan Project, causes the Manhattan Project to start. In any case, by 1945, they had, in fact, constructed atomic bombs, dropped a couple on Japan. 200,000 people died as a result of the bombing of Hiroshima and then Nagasaki. But in 46, 47, and 48, these folks at the Manhattan Project, at the secret laboratories that were created at Los Alamos, at Oak Ridge, the Hanford Reservation up in Washington, at what's now called Argonne, they look for ways to perpetuate this enormous vested interest. And as I say, it was in part corporate. You had GE and Westinghouse seeking to keep those contracts going, and it was part government opening offices, opening laboratories with people who wanted to see their positions continued, and they looked for other things to be done with nuclear power. They figured, well, I mean, they can continue to build nuclear weapons, and they did tens of thousands of them, but you can't really peddle an atomic bomb even to England or France. What else could be done with nuclear technology to perpetuate this nuclear establishment? And there comes these ideas of nuclear-powered rockets, RTGs, these plutonium-powered electrical systems, nuclear-powered airplanes, food irradiation, and then nuclear power plants. Some people will say, oh, it was guilt that led the scientists of the Manhattan Project after the war to look for the peaceful uses of nuclear technology. In my research, and I've been doing it for decades, it ain't guilt, it's greed, greed. And what they created in terms of atomic energy, the claim of peaceful nuclear power, is complete baloney. I mean, nuclear war and civilian nuclear power are two sides of the same coin. There's no peaceful atom, never was.
You're listening to the Project Censored Show on Pacifica Radio. I'm Mickey Huff. We're speaking with professor and investigative reporter Carl Grossman. We'll continue that conversation after this break. Stay with us. We're speaking with Professor Carl Grossman. He is an author of 6 books. He's behind several documentaries. He has worked for a very long time, an investigative reporter and academic, calling out the myth of safe nuclear energy or nuclear power. You've written about the nuclear power plants on the eastern side of the U.S. Can you tell us a little bit about that? You wrote a piece about the Indian Point not long ago. Again, if your listeners want to learn more, you can go to carlgrossman.com. That's Carl with a K, Grossman with two S's. You can see Carl Grossman's writings there. Carl, can you tell us a little bit about that?
Indian Point is a catastrophe waiting to happen. It's essentially on where two earthquake faults meet, one the Ramapo Fault, 26 miles from the New York City line, just along the Hudson River. 40-year-old nuclear plants that current owners of want to get relicensed to run another 20 years. I mean, nuclear power plants were never seen as running for more than 40 years because of the radiation causing embrittlement, the metals in particular. 40 years was to be the limit. But now the Nuclear Regulatory Commission, which is essentially a rubber stamp operation dominated by the nuclear establishment, which includes the nuclear industry, has extended the licenses. We have 99 operating nuclear plants in the country right now. Over 70 are now being allowed to run another 20 years, in other words, 60 years. The NRC is talking 80 years. In fact, just in recent weeks, I've seen pieces where some of these nuclear promoters in our regulatory system are saying, well, why not 100 years? Just consider taking a car 60 or 80 years old, running it at high speed on an interstate. Robert Pollan of the Union of Concerned Scientists, he coined the term an accident waiting to happen. In regard to Indian Point, this is decades ago, and there's been numerous accidents through the years. Only a recent one, this big transformer explosion at Indian Point. This is a catastrophe waiting to happen, but these special interests, they are controlling the ship of state, pushing and pushing, continuing to push atomic energy. Even, like, when I wrote my first book on nuclear power, this is after the Three Mile Island accident convinced me of the enormous danger of these machines called cover up what you are not supposed to know about nuclear power. In fact, if anybody wants to download it for free, absolutely for free, go to my website, carlgrossman.com. And in cover up is a chapter, again, we're talking 1970s technology, about alternatives to nuclear, solar and wind and so forth. That was near 40 years ago. Today, there is utterly no need, completely no need for nuclear power. All our energy can be provided for, can be supplied by safe, clean means, topped by solar and wind, of course. But meanwhile, those in, and not just the nuclear forces here, we're talking about nuclear, we're talking about oil and the folks into, in terms of that industry, fracking. We're talking about gas, the gas industry, the so-called natural gas industry, and coal are trying to suppress this bonanza that it's all on the shelves now. It's here today of safe, clean energy.
We're speaking with Professor Carl Grossman. We're speaking about nuclear energy, nuclear power, nuclear weaponry. Of course, we're underscoring the myth that this is safe and clean. But Carl Grossman, I wanted to go back a moment because when we were talking about Indian Point, you mentioned two fault lines. A lot of folks, when they think New York, they don't think fault lines. And of course, in California, Diablo Canyon, right, is certainly a comparison that comes to mind. In California, we certainly have our own problems with fault lines running under nuclear power plants. Can you elaborate on that just a little bit, or at least underscore that once again, that in fact Indian Point is in an extremely precarious location?
22 million people live within 50 miles of the Indian Point plant, and you have these fault lines. You don't have the situation you have around Diablo Canyon, which is unbelievable. I mean, I've been to Diablo Canyon. Terribly dangerous twin nuclear plants right next to an earthquake fault, and a big, big one. It's beyond the Ramapo fault. I mean, very, very serious. To put a nuke anywhere, in my judgment, is, as I say, totally unnecessary and toxic. But to put a nuke, you know, on or near an earthquake fault, whether it be in New York or whether it be on the Pacific in California or whether it be on the Pacific in Japan, it's suicide. If these nuclear scientists and these executives of GE and Westinghouse all want to kind of live under a lead geodesic dome that covers a nuclear plant and somehow would, and this can't be the case, would somehow seal it all, But, you know, we're not volunteers here. We're people all over are being faced with the impacts of nuclear technology. You don't need, and this is so important for people to understand, a catastrophic accident to have the radioactivity in a nuclear plant get out and affect life. I mean, any nuclear power plant routinely emits radiation. It's allowed routine emissions, they call these releases. And getting back to, this myth of the peaceful atom, any nuclear power plant produces what's the preferred fuel for an atomic bomb, plutonium. I mean, at Diablo Canyon and Indian Point, each of those plants, there's two in each of those sites, each produces 400 to 500 pounds of plutonium a year. Any nuclear power plant anywhere, it's an atomic bomb factory. We had this crazy Atoms for Peace program, and through it, we trained Indian engineers. The Canadians supplied India with a reactor, Atoms for Peace, 1974 then, because they had trained personnel and they had the material. They had the plutonium from that reactor. They had the bomb. Again, there's no separation between nuclear war and nuclear power. Two sides of the same coin. And in my judgment, the way to deal with this, now this might sound radical, but what we've been trying to do through the years is sort of carrot and a stick to kind of control this menace. In my judgment, it's not going to work, because as long as nuclear power plants are allowed to be built, in fact promoted all over the world, we just give any nation with a nuclear power facility has, as I say, the material, the plutonium, and the trained personnel to make nuclear weapons, to make atomic bombs. The United Nations has designated portions of the planet nuclear-free zones, though they're mostly focusing, they are focusing on nuclear weapons. I think the only way out of this mess is to have the whole world, the whole planet, designated a nuclear-free zone, no nuclear weapons, no nuclear power, period. And for those who say you can't put the genie back in the bottle, look what happened after World War One. I mean, nations realized the horrific nature of chemical warfare and entered into treaties to ban chemical weapons. So, I mean, they've not worked perfectly, but to a large degree they have worked to ban chemical weapons. We have to do the same thing with nuclear technology. This is a horrific technology promoted and pushed for profit and power by a huge nuclear establishment, both here in the United States and also, might I say, in Russia. And I've been to Russia numerous times, speaking as I'm speaking now about the dangers of nuclear power. The ship of state, all the states, must change course. We must comprehend, understand, acknowledge what a horrific technology this is, and get that genie back in the bottle so our grandchildren and their grandchildren can survive, because the stick and the carrot approach is not going to work. I mean, it may sound radical, but I think that's what I'm saying, but I think the more radical approach is to try to do this stick and carrot tap dance. We got to say no to nuclear power and no to nuclear weapons anywhere on this planet.
Professor Carl Grossman, that's a fine note for us to end on, and certainly something for all of us to ponder, to think about the dangers of nuclear power. Thank you so much, Carl Grossman, for joining us on the Project Censored show today.
A pleasure, Mickey.
Supporting human conditions, not free market propaganda and corrupt politicians, cause they own by special interest groups that fund their campaigns. That's why you hear the same old things they claim, but change never came. It's a dirty game maintained by rain for capital gain.
And that's our program for today. Thanks so much for joining us. The Project Censored show airs on 25 stations around the U.S. For more information and to listen to archives of previous shows, go to www.projectcensored.org. Please follow and like us on Facebook. Anthony Fest is our producer. Erica Bridgman is our engineer. I'm Mickey Huff. We'll see you next time.
Prime for free.
debate about criminal minds, political ties, habitual eyes, alibis, skies, another guy's democracy, politics, the apocalypse, got the skies looking ominous. So the ocean burn bright with waves full of poison, genocide, pools.
This is Brian Edwards Tiekert, very excited to be working on Upfront, weekdays at 7 a.m. with a talented team.
I'm Sonali Kolhatkar. Each morning we bring you the latest from the streets of Oakland to the halls of the state capital, from Los Angeles to Afghanistan. We deliver in-depth analysis, hard-hitting interviews and debates on the issues that affect our lives.
And I'm Eileen Alfandari, working with the KPFA news team to bring you breaking news from across the state, the region and the world. We'll keep you updated on the latest throughout the morning on KPFA.
It's Upfront, a statewide collaboration that brings you information that matters. That's every weekday morning at 7.